terms allowance, price collar, offset, and abatement have in common? You guessed it. These are all key design features of emissions trading schemes. But what do they do? And how should they be managed by a company that needs to comply with an emissions trading scheme? First things first. Understanding all the design features of an emissions trading scheme is important. So we'll start at the beginning with scheme coverage. Depending on the government's target, the geographical coverage of an ETS can focus on one or more cities, states, countries or regions. Within this geographical boundary, an ETS can also cover one or more industry sectors, such as manufacturing, mining, power generation, oil refining and transport. Now, if your company has a facility within a geographical area and industry sector covered by an ETS, this doesn't automatically mean your company has an ETS compliance obligation. This is because most schemes also have an emissions compliance threshold and only cover companies or facilities that exceed this. For example, an ETS may have a threshold for power generation companies of 50,000 tonnes of carbon dioxide equivalent per year. A company would calculate the carbon footprint across its organisation, and if it falls below 50,000 tonnes of CO2 equivalent per year, it does not have to comply. It's important to note that emissions trading schemes generally only apply to Scope 1 emissions, such as those being directly emitted by a power plant's flue stack. And the emissions covered by the scheme may include all 7 greenhouse gases, as defined by the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change, or just a single gas, such as carbon dioxide. In summary, as a company, you need to check a scheme's geographical, industry sector, and emissions coverage to know if you need to comply or not. Most schemes operate on a yearly cycle, but some are divided into different phases, comprising several years, such as the EU ETS. These trading schemes also have an end date, for example 2020, that govern when the emissions reduction target must be met. The target guides the government in setting the emissions cap, which is gradually lowered over time until it meets the target at the end date of the scheme. The volume of allowances available for compliance should match the scheme emissions cap. Now, the rules of the game are quite straightforward. At the end of the compliance period, liable companies need to surrender or give up one allowance for every tonne of greenhouse gases it emits over that period. For example, a company that emits 50,000 tonnes of CO2 equivalent will need to surrender 50,000 allowances to the government. Okay, so how does a company obtain allowances? Initially, the government may allocate a proportion of total allowances available for free to companies within one or more sectors. The intention of this is to soften the financial impact on industries that cannot easily reduce their emissions, or that are exposed to external competitors not covered by an ETS. The remainder of allowances are usually sold through auctions. Allowances are usually valid for the same year that they are released, but some schemes allow allowances to be bought in advance. These allowances are called future vintages and can be only used in the year that they are sold for. In the auction, some companies may receive more allowances than they need, and others will receive too few. Companies that have too many allowances may sell these on the secondary market to those companies who have too few. The secondary market includes the trading of allowances over an electronic exchange or directly between the buyer and seller. This is referred to as over-the-counter trading. Companies with excess allowances may, alternatively, choose to bank them for future use. This can be a useful strategy to provide some price certainty when the carbon price is anticipated to increase in future years. However, it's important to note that some emissions trading schemes limit the amount of allowances that a company can bank. For example, the Korean ETS imposes a banking limit of 10% of a company's annual emissions. So, if company X has a compliance obligation of 60,000 tonnes of CO2 equivalent, then it can only bank a maximum of 6,000 allowances for future use. Some emissions trading schemes allow for carbon offset credits to be used in addition to allowances. The term offsetting means a reduction in greenhouse gas emissions in one place to compensate for greenhouse gases emitted elsewhere. As with allowances, one offset equals one tonne of CO2 equivalent reduced. Offsets are often cheaper than allowances for emissions trading schemes in industrialised countries, chiefly because most offsets are created in developing countries where project costs are lower. For this reason, offsets are an attractive compliance option. However, it should be noted that many emissions trading schemes have limits on the number of offsets that can be used for compliance. For example, the ETS regulator may impose a rule that a maximum of 10% of the compliance obligation can be met by offsets. Now, let's not forget the main purpose of an ETS is to reduce emissions. Companies should consider their internal abatement options, such as energy efficiency improvements, when contemplating the purchase of allowances or offsets. Remember our marginal abatement cost curves? If an abatement option is cheaper than the price of allowances or offsets, then it's probably the better compliance option. One major concern for emissions trading schemes is the risk of volatile market prices, such as those observed in the early years of the EU ETS. Volatile market prices are difficult for companies to manage and create headaches for government in forecasting auction revenue. To increase price predictability, government can use so-called safety valves. These include setting a price collar by specifying a minimum and maximum price that allowances can be bid for at auction. Another method may involve releasing additional allowances from a government-held reserve to reduce the market price if the carbon price increases too much. So there you have it. There are many variables in the design of an emissions trading scheme. Understanding these key design features is critical for organisations if they are going to manage their compliance obligation effectively.